Okay, so welcome back to the afternoon session. I mean, now comes the part of the school where I kind of discuss different things which have not been worked out in full detail. So it means the discussion session and the parts where I explain something will may be mixed together. And I thought, since there were many people asked me yesterday, now what is the connection to Fox space, what is a quantum state here, and so on, let me try to explain all this in this usual setting which you are familiar with from quantum field theory. Let me suppose we want to describe a scattering process and what is kind of the ingoing state, what is the outcoming state, and so on. What is the connection here? And as I said, I mean, this is just like a kind of overview. Also, this is like ongoing work. I will then mention a few people with whom I work together. And yes, and of course, feel free to comment anytime. Okay, the situation we have in mind is that we are, say, Minkowski space. So we have here Minkowski space. And then at some time t0 in the past, we prescribe some initial data. So this means we have some incoming kind of scattering states, so like electrons and photons or whatever. And at the beginning, they have like a linear dynamics. So what this is what I mean, there's no interaction taking place. And then there's like an interaction region. So this means like if you kind of shoot things together, then the amplitudes of the fields in this interaction region get so large that they all, that there's really like an interaction taking place. And then there are things kind of flying out. And at the final time, t1, then one looks at what the outcome of the scattering experiment is. Okay, so this is the setting. And now how can we describe this in our framework? And we had this perturbation expansion. And let me write this down again, like symbolically, in a form which is convenient. Okay, first of all, we say rho is just a vacuum measure. So this describes Minkowski space, and then and rho tilde, so this is the measure describing the scattering experiment. So rho tilde sozusagen describes the interacting system. Okay, and then we are again working with this ansatz, which we use for the scattering, for the perturbation expansion yesterday. So we make the ansatz that the scattering, so the interacting measure should have the form capital F star times little f times rho. And then for the capital F and little f, we plug in a power expansion, like in powers of lambda. So lambda can be thought of as the coupling constant. Lambda to the p times f, p little f, okay, so this is just like a perturbation ansatz, and we are not concerned about convergence of the series, we just want to compute things order by order in lambda. Okay, and then we had like also like a Green's operator last time. So we have like a Green's S. And then we could always write this little fp, capital Fp, we could write this as the Green's operator acting on the previous jets, acting on is what we called Ep, And this EP now depends on all the previous jets. Maybe I use right away this notation, which I also did used yesterday. Maybe I call WP is equal to little fp and capital FP. And then this EP here depends on W1 to WP minus 1. And maybe on the left side, I also write WP okay, so this is like the general form of the perturbation expansion, and this can be kind of solved iteratively, and everything can be expressed in terms of W1. I mean, suppose here comes a W2, then you can express it in terms of W1 from the second order term and so on. So inductively, one sees that the WP can be expressed in the following form. This is just like a convenient notation, SP, and then I have here W1, and again W1, and W1, and this comes up P times, so P factors, and this SP is then just multilinear. So SP is just a multilinear, that you need P factors, this is just in order to get the orders in lambda right. So this is like the symbolic form. And therefore, I can also write maybe the sum over all these W's. So W, so P equal to 1 to infinity of these WPs, or maybe with a lambda to the P inside. This is, of course, just the same as, let's see, P equal to 0. This is, of course, this capital little f, capital F. And this here, well, maybe I give, don't give this a name, otherwise it gets too confusing. Okay, and this can then be written as follows. So I start with P equal to 0. Well, in this case, I just did little f is constant 1, the capital F is just the identity. Then I get lambda times W1 plus, and then I have here lambda square times S2 of W1 plus lambda cubed S3 of W1 and so on. And of course, I mean, the S2 here, this is really like the Green's operator, and well, basically like this is the same as S acting on E2 of W1, whereas these higher guys, they have kind of has a complicated structure involving many, many Green's operators, so it can be depicted as some kind of sums of Feynman diagrams, if you like. Okay, so I mean, this is like, I mean, this is clear, this general structure. I mean, this is just to keep the notation as simple as possible and so on.
So yesterday, this perturbation theory you presented, it was for classical external potential.
Yes.
So are you still considering the interaction with classical external potential?
Yeah, good point. I mean, right now I don't specify this. In fact, like, if I look at this ansatz here, then I would say yes. Because, but if I took into account this, fragmentation, then I would say then it's a second quantized field. So let's keep this question open for the moment, and then later we can discuss, is this already classical, is it quantum, and so on. Also, I haven't shown you how the perturbation expansion with fragmentation works. This is also something I wanted to do tomorrow, just to... Yes. Basically describes everything. So it describes the system both at the beginning, during the interaction region, or like when the interaction takes place, and after the interaction. Okay, but now this is in fact like what I'll explain this a little better now. In order to make this clear, I mean, here we always these Green's operators come up. And I mentioned yesterday that at least in the continuum limit, and let's suppose this is what we are continuing right now, looking at right now, then this Green's operator here can be expressed in terms of these Dirac and Maxwell Green's operators. And so they can be written down explicitly, and also one can choose advanced or retarded guys. And what we do now is just choose the S as retarded Green's operators. So choose all Green's operators as retarded Green's operators. And this makes things a little bit easier because then, I mean, this is just like for matter of presentation. This is not really essential. It just keeps the picture here a little bit simpler because then here in the past, the rho tilde is equal to rho because the perturbation only changes things to the future. But of course here in the future, so okay, of course here the rho tilde is not equal to rho, but also here in the future, the rho tilde is not equal to rho. But I mean, we want that the system here in the future is no longer interacting. What does this mean? So this simply means that the sum of all these jets can be considered as a solution of the linearized field equation. So now if I compute, and this is what I call W asymptotic, so I just sum over all these different jets, but now I start at p from p equal 1 to infinity, lambda to the p wp, that this here is then the solution of the linearized field equations, okay, in the asymptotic region. So up here in the future of the interaction. Okay. Well, and similarly down here, so I think I made a mistake. Well, this is not quite correct what I wrote here. Namely, I mean, the rho tilde here is just the measure describing our initial data. I mean, if rho tilde were rho, we would just describe the vacuum, so nothing would happen. So what I do here is initial data, this is described by W1, which again is a solution of the linearized field equations in the past. And then the rho tilde is simply described by, let's write it like, let's see, rho. Well, I must be a bit careful to get a good notation. 1 plus capital F1 star times 1 plus F1 times rho. Let's just write it like this. So it's like, again, like the same construction. We multiply the measure and we take a push forward, but we only consider the first order contribution, just the linear perturbation. And this double and this linear perturbation should be like a solution of the linearized field equations here in the past. Okay, so what happens? So we have, first of all, this linearized, as long as this is a linearized solution, all these higher orders of W do not come into play. But once, like as I said, so then the whole, everything kind of flies together, the amplitude gets larger, and then here one has an interaction. So this means here W2, W3, W4, and so on are created by the interaction, and they are still present over here. You see, so they come up here, but what flies out is then again a solution of the linearized field equations. Okay, so this is, I mean, this is like a simple way to model a scattering process.
Can it be connected to the loop level calculations?
You mean like, so you mean like loop levels, you mean like really quantum field theory computations? So you mean, I mean, I don't know, understand what you mean by loop level. I know no tree level, I know what you mean. Loop level just means everything.
Yeah, no, tree levels. I mean, like,
tree levels. Yeah. Okay, I mean, this is very similar to the perturbation expansion on the tree level. And in fact, you get like a precise correspondence if you work with classical fields, and this is exactly the same thing. And, but what I want, of course, what we are more interested in is to also get loop diagrams, and how do you get them? Are they the same as in quantum field theory and all of that? And okay, so that's what I want to explain. And a priori, it really just looks like tree diagrams. I think this is what you kind of meant. Or not. Exactly, and on the tree level, I mean, there's no distinction. Everything agrees anyway, so there's no problem. Well, I mean, it's everything is nonlinear, huh? So there is some self-interaction. I mean, but of course, the question is, can you describe it as the usual kind of self-interaction as described by loop diagrams?
So the causal fermion moving backwards in time?
Well, that's the question. I mean, of course, I mean, if you look at the causal action principle, well, then there is an interaction both to the future and to the past. And then this rho tilde is determined kind of in a difficult nonlinear way. And so therefore, the question just is like, what does this mean? I mean, like, can you rewrite this in terms of usual Feynman diagrams? And does one also get loop diagrams and so on? And in the end, I mean, the answer will be yes. And this is like I will try to explain you. Let's also discuss this later then. Okay, so this is like the setting we have. And of course, all this looks very difficult at first, simply because this perturbation expansion is very complicated. If you want to compute things, it's very complicated, in particular if this like fragmentation of the measure is taken into account, what I mentioned like towards the end yesterday, then it gets kind of out of control and it's not really clear what's going on. But at least in order to kind of simplify the situation, there are these conserved surface layer integrals, I mean, so which Johannes introduced, and they give us some additional structure. And the hope is that by making use of these conserved quantities, one can understand the structure of this whole scattering process better and maybe also rewrite this in a more familiar form. Okay, maybe just recall the surface layer conserved surface layer integrals, and one has to be careful. Those were for linearized solutions. But right now, this W is not a linear solution. I mean, this is like a nonlinear solution. We just know it's like linear at the beginning and at the end. But in order to have like conservation, it has to be a linearized solution at all times. So therefore, we can't work with W directly, but we need to linearize around W. For linearized solution, and to this end, so we linearize around rho tilde. So in other words, we perturb rho tilde, but only linearly. Now, how does this work? Well, this can be done as follows. We just say, let me think of what's the best way to do it. I mean, maybe it's best to do it like this. So now we have the F, the little f, and the capital F. They depend on W1. So just this bracket means that it depends on this. So namely, once I've W1 is kind of my input, and then I compute everything, and then I get little f and capital F. Okay, so this is like the but I'm free to choose W1 and W1 here. Now what I do is I just take F, I take this solution, but now for W1 plus, let's not call it lambda because this is already used, plus mu times U1. So the U1 should now be a linearized solution of the unperturbed measure. Maybe let me not even write this down, otherwise it gets a bit confusing. So it should be this linearized solution in the past. Well, maybe let's write it like this. So this is like a linearized solution in the past. Okay, now I differentiate this d by d mu at mu equal to 0, and this is what I call u tilde. And this is in fact a linearized solution of the perturbed measure. Well, linearized simply where we took the first derivative in terms of mu, and of course, yeah, yes. I can also write this down a bit more explicitly using the formula here. This is why you see that this formula is quite useful. So, namely, if we write this lit, so we have like this formula here. Now the W1 is just replaced by W1 plus mu times U1 everywhere. And then if we differentiate it, we just make use of the multilinearity. So what we get is that u tilde is equal to, let's just write this down, d mu of, then we have here like the identity plus lambda times W1 plus mu times U1 plus lambda square times S2 of W1 plus mu times U1 W1 plus mu times U1 plus and so on. And then at mu equal to 0. So what we get here, well, the identity drops out, and then we get lambda times U1 plus lambda square times 2 times S2 of W1 U1 plus 3 times lambda cube times S3 of W1 U1 and so on. And this is really like linear, well, simply because the U1 comes up as a linear term everywhere. So it's linear here, linear here, linear here, and so on. But it still depends non-linearly on W1. Okay, and this is like kind of a linearized solution. This means for this U tilde, well, and similarly V tilde. So let's just write it like this. U tilde and V tilde are in J lin tilde. And tilde always refers to the interacting system. Okay. And for those, I have the conservation laws. Okay, conservation laws. I focus on this symplectic form and this scalar product. So we have sigma of u tilde v tilde, and for clarity I put here a tilde or rho tilde in order to make sure this is the symplectic form of the interacting system. So this is conserved in time. In other words, if I can compute it as any time, I get the same thing. And in particular, it's the same as what I had at the very beginning, but at time t0, I can write this as just the unperturbed measure. And then I have here U1, V1. Because there's nothing else here. So this is just like this symplectic form without interaction, and this is like the symplectic form with interaction. And in particular, I can compute this now maybe at final time. Yeah, and there's no points. I mean, final. So this is like at time t1. This is at time t0. Well, and we don't really care what happens in between for the moment. So we just, well, as usual in physics, well, physicists are mainly just interested in what in the outcome of the experiment is and not what happens in between, and we take here the same point of view. Okay, and then we have like this, also, so this is like this symplectic form. And then there's also this inner product, rho tilde, which is conserved, not quite. So there was this kind of volume term. So this can be written again as U1 V1 rho. So with at initial time plus this volume term okay, now the question is how to treat this volume term. So it turns out that this can be compensated by scaling the measure. I mean, here the main point is only the scalar components of all these jets come into play, and they can be modified by multiplying the measure by a constant. So this here can be compensated by suitable rescaling of rho tilde, but the rescaling has to depend on U11 and V1. Suitable of rho tilde depending on okay. Well, this is, well, one has to be careful here, but it turns out that this volume term can really be transformed away. So this means that this symmetric bilinear form is also conserved in time. So now we have like these two conservation laws, and this is the surface layer scalar product, as we call it, and it turns out, as I told you, there's this long paper where I compute this in the continuum limit, like in Minkowski space, that this is in fact positive definite. So it's a reasonable assumption, at least, to that this is positive definite. I could also put it differently. I mean, I'm still free to choose all this jet test here. Somehow here I could say I make this test space smaller. And by choosing this appropriately, it is will be positive definite, but still I have all the jets in my jet spaces which seem of physical interest. So like these fermionic and bosonic jets are still there. Okay. But also, I mean, these are more like technical points, of course. For the moment, let's just assume that this is really positive. So assume positive definiteness. Let me see, I want to keep. Exactly, so this formula over there should stay on the blackboard. Okay, now what do these conserved quantities give us? Well, what I want to explain now is that they in fact give like a complex structure. Maybe this is so let's just do this start a new paragraph, a complex structure on the jet space. And let's just explain this for this tilde space. So let's look at those bilinear forms here. So we assume, and this is kind of also like a reasonable assumption, although, well, for those, still it's an assumption here, that first of all, this rho tilde, so this is positive definite. So therefore, I can form the completion, and then I get a real Hilbert space. So let's just call this H real. So this is then basically, so I take this, let's also put a tilde. So I take these, all these jet spaces and take them the completion with respect to the scalar product. Well, the next assumption is that this sigma is non-degenerate. And it's bounded with respect to the scalar product. Bounded, so this means that sigma of u tilde v tilde is small or equal to a constant times the norm of u tilde, and the norm is like this norm on this Hilbert space here for all in h r tilde. And then I can again represent one, so the bilinear, so this symplectic form relative to the scalar product. So this means the representation, this is then this Ries representation. Gives a unique operator S such that this sigma of u tilde v tilde, and I should also have put here rho tilde here, is equal to u tilde s v tilde rho tilde. Okay, and this is a bit similar to when we constructed this local correlation operator. So we first constructed by linear form and then represented relative to a scalar product. Okay. And also let's call it S tilde here because we have tildes everywhere. And this operator S tilde is in fact anti-symmetric. Why? Well, we know that this here is anti-symmetric, the symplectic form is anti-symmetric. So then we get here V minus V tilde S tilde U tilde rho tilde, but now this scalar product is symmetric. So we get here minus S tilde U tilde V tilde rho tilde. So there, this shows that S star is equal to minus S. Okay, now what's kind of the goal? So what we want is, we want to construct an operator J with J star is equal to minus J and J square is equal to minus the identity. Why? What's the point of doing this? I mean, suppose we have such a J, then this defines as a complex structure on the jet space. In simple terms, you can say, well, then the J plays the role of I. Well, and then of course I star is minus I and I square is minus one. So then you get the usual computation rules for I. Okay, how can this be done? Well, this can be done just using some kind of taking again like a polar decomposition, kind of. I mean, the S here, well, it's not diagonalizable on a real Hilbert space. One way is that you say, well, I just complexify the Hilbert space and then I can diagonalize it. And then this J has purely imaginary eigenvalues. And then I take the eigenspace, then I take define I as the operator which on the eigenspaces with positive imaginary part has the eigenvalue plus I, and on those with a negative imaginary part it has the eigenvalue minus I. So that's one of way of doing it. We're very similar to the construction of this sine operator before lunch. So the only difference is that now the eigenvalues are imaginary. But one can also do it a little bit, well, one doesn't need to complexify this stage, and maybe it's better not to do it. Namely, what we do is simply define J as minus S squared to the power minus 1/2 times S. Well, and this minus S squared, this can also be written as S star times S to the power minus 1/2, because S star is minus S, and then you see that this is really like a positive operator, and you can hope for computing the inverse here. So in fact, like this non-degeneracy assumption implies that this S has no kernel, and then this whole product here can be made sense of. Okay. So then we have an operator which has the desired properties. So gen J square is equal to minus 1, and J star is equal to minus J. I mean, you just compute it directly. And therefore, it defines a complex structure. Okay, maybe let me just explain a bit better how this goes. Because at least it took me a while to really understand how to do this. So more precisely, so first of all, one defines the HC as, well, just pairs. So this is something like HR plus I times HR. And then you introduce, well, just well, this is just a definition of this is a complex Hilbert set. There's the usual complexification. And it's done in such a way that the complex dimension is the same as the real dimension was before. So kind of, in other words, the real dimension is double, which you see also from this. Okay, then one can also complexify the scalar product in order to obtain a sesquilinear form. So this means you just define whatever U plus IV W plus IX. And then I put here usually now this inside, because now everything is complex. So just define this as U W minus I times V W plus I times U X plus V X. And this gives me like a sesquilinear form. And gives me also a complex Hilbert space. Now, in order to, now still the dimension is double, so I don't want that. What one does now is one introduces a new scalar product where here I put 1 plus I j inside. So this is what I define to be the complex. And basically this means that here I only get pick the holomorphic part on the right side and the anti-holomorphic on the left side. And this is like a good way to do this complexification. Sure. Yes, it depends what you want to do. I mean, if you want to complexify the tension bundle, then I mean, and there's a distinction between there's an almost complex structure and then there's a complex structure and a Kähler structure and so on. So there are different conditions you can impose and so on. Well, here this is just like on a vector space, and you complexify this vector space. Of course, if you then consider whatever the solution, the space of all solutions, this kind of Fréchet manifold, then this construction just gives you basically like an almost complex structure. So at each point of the solution space, at each row tilde, you get a complex, this almost complex structure on the tangent space. And then, well, then it's a good question. Does it give rise also to a complex structure or as whatever? Is it, for example, yeah, and but this, well, we haven't analyzed in detail. It seems that in this scattering case, because like in the past, everything is non-interacting, it seems that it automatically gives rise to a complex structure because everything is flat. And I should have said we, I mean, so this is like joint work with Nikki Kamran from McGill in Montreal, and we are just working this out. So this is why I don't want to claim too much. So it seems as if it really gives like a complex structure on the space of all solutions, on the tangent bundle of the solution space, if you like. Okay, but what we do now, I mean, the rho tilde is fixed anyway. We are just dealing with the tangent space, with one tangent space, and then that's all we need. Okay, but now what I want to explain, do I still have this on the blackboard? Now I did erase what I wanted to leave on the blackboard. Well, anyway, let me just explain, first of all, what this means. Namely, and let's draw this, what does now the conservation mean? So we have here T0, we have here T1, and then we have here this sigma rho tilde of u tilde v tilde. This is the same as sigma rho of u1 v1. Okay, and this can now be expressed in terms of the scalar product. So this is u tilde j tilde v tilde. Well, not quite, s tilde. And down here we have like u1 S V1. So, and these are all the same. And then, of course, we can also take here U tilde V tilde. And we have here U1 V1, and they also agree. So we have these conservation laws. Okay, and what this tells us is the following. We can now go around here. Namely, let's see how precise, yeah. So we know that u tilde s tilde v tilde is equal to yeah, u1 s v1. And now I just put a bracket around here. I mean, this is, I just do it like this. U1 S V1. And if you like, we can call this, give this a new name, A1, which now takes the role of the V1 here. And then we see this is the same as U tilde S V1 tilde. In other words, what we see is that S tilde V tilde is the same as S V1 tilde. So in other words, if we multiply a time t0 with S, or if we multiply a time t1 with S tilde, gives the same result, which kind of expresses that this operator S is kind of invariant, so it's invariant in this sense. Okay, now I need to write down again this formula, which I had before, namely, what is this S tilde V, or what's the V tilde? So the V tilde, this had the form, so this is equal to V1 plus 2 lambda S2 of W1 V1 plus 3 lambda square S3 of W1 VW1 V1 plus and so on. This is like the equation where I told you that everything is now, this is like a linearized solution, so everything is linear in V1. Okay. And now the point is now if we multiply this by S tilde here, then of course we multiply the right side here by S tilde. But this is the same as, let's just do it like this, S tilde V tilde, this is the same as if I now in each argument here put in an S. So this is S V1 plus 2 lambda S2 W1 S V1 plus, and then, well, the same thing, and here I put S V1 again plus and so on. So like each V1 is now replaced by S times V1. Okay, and this what I did just with S, you can also do it with S square. So you can multiply again by S tilde, and then you get an additional factor S in here and so on. And this shows that you can do the same, play the same game with any spec, any operator obtained from S and S tilde by the spectral calculus. In particular, we can do it for the operator J. So the same equation holds for J. And then we can also take an operator which is like idempotent, namely 1 plus I times J tilde. And then we see that we get kind of an interesting structure of the of all the terms which show up in the perturbation expansion. This is what we call like holomorphic perturbation expansion. Then it works as follows. I mean, first of all, if we take 1 plus I gamma tilde square, no, sorry, not gamma, J tilde squared. This is, of course, like 1 plus I J tilde squared plus 2 I J tilde. Well, in this J tilde square is minus 1, I square is also minus 1, so this just gives 1 here. And then we get like 2 times 1 plus I J tilde. So therefore, I can just do the following. 1 plus I J tilde V tilde is equal to 1 half. And then I just square this guy. 1 plus I j tilde v tilde times, just do it like this, 1 plus I j tilde v tilde. And now these factors, as I said, I mean, this is like an operator which is obtained from the S tilde using the spectral calculus. I can use the same formula here. So I get 1 half times 1 plus I j tilde times V1. Oh, sorry, I get like here 1 plus I j tilde V1 plus 2 lambda S2 of W1 1 plus ij. Now no tilde here because this is like at the initial time, plus, and maybe I don't write out all the terms. And on the other hand, if I had done this right away here, I get the same expression, but there's just a V1 here and the V1's here and so on. In other words, it makes no difference if here I plug in this 1 plus ij or not. So what does this mean? So this means that the 1 plus ij tilde times, for example, S2 of W1. Now if I take here the other guy, 1 minus ij V1 is equal to 0. And the same for S3, S4, and so on. No, here it's 1 plus ij. Well, here, the up to here, I'm working always with 1 plus ij. Yeah, also here. Aha, let's see. No, I think also this should be fine. So this 1 plus ij tilde is kind of idempotent. Let's just write this again. So 1 half times 1 plus ij squared is 1 half times 1 plus ij. And if I put here, on the other hand, if I take 1 plus ij times 1 minus ij, this gives 0. So therefore, the fact that I can replace the V1 here by 1 plus, the fact that I can add here this term 1 plus ij implies that if I start with something which has here 1 minus ij, I get 0. Is it clear? I mean, this is all on the linear level. I mean, of course, I have then here also the W's, here W1, W1, and then 1 minus ij V1 is equal to 0. So all the W1s are not affected, only kind of this is only a statement on the linearization. Okay, but now we can use the fact that this here is totally symmetric. So this is like a multilinear, this comes from the expansion and is by definition symmetric in all its arguments. If in the last argument we can put in a 1 plus ij and get 0, we can do the same at any other argument. And what does this mean? So this shows that if you call those guys here, say, holomorphic, so you think of this, you have can think of that z and z bar, say, this here projects onto z, and therefore, so the z bar is kind of projected out. And then what you get is again holomorphic. So this is kind of a power expansion in the holomorphic part. And similarly, of course, if you take the anti-holomorphic contribution, it only involves powers of the anti-holomorphic part of the Z bars. I mean, is it clear? So in other words, what we can do now, we decompose. So we take this HC and we decompose it into H holomorphic plus H anti-holomorphic. where this is defined simply by, this is like 1 minus ij times the complexified guy, and similarly this is 1 plus ij times the complexification. So the complexification is split up into this holomorphic and anti-holomorphic part. And then this SP is then a mapping from just the holomorphic guys. And we have then here P factors to holomorphic now with the tilde, because this is like at the final time. I mean, is this clear how this works? Okay, now what is all this good for? So the goal is to get a unitary time evolution on a Fock space. So what we have right now is a nonlinear evolution, but a nonlinear evolution which is compatible with the complex structure, and really in each argument. And therefore, if we now just linearize, or I mean like a nonlinear or multilinear operator like SP, can be written as a linear operator on the tensor product. And if we do this, then we get like a complex linear operator, which preserves the complex scalar product, in other words, which is really like unitary. Maybe let me go through this a bit in detail. Let me see how much time. Okay. So now comes the Fock space construction. Well, and the good thing is that this is really very, looks very similar to what one has in quantum field theory. So I take, first of all, I define FP, so the P particle Fock space, as the symmetric tensor product of P copies of this holomorphic H or Hollander, I feel like here P factors. As I said, so this is just the symmetric tensor product. Okay, then I define the whole Fock space as usual as the sum over the direct sum of all these P particle Fock spaces. So this is now basically like the ingoing Fock space. Okay, and now I can introduce like a linear operator. Maybe I'll write this over here. Well, on the other hand, let's just keep going here. Of course, I'll use this formula again. So introduce like an operator U from F to H tilde to the holomorphic part here. And what is this? Namely, I just say U acting on the P particle sector. So let's just say U or V1 tensor VP is just defined as SP of V1 and VP. Well, and then this definition then extends by linearity and by the way this Fock space is constructed. So then this extends in a unique way to the Fock space. In other words, this is like a good definition. So this defines this operator, linear operator U. So now this is like complex linear. Okay, and then what is now the statement of what we had here? So we know that the, what is now this, how did we call this U tilde? We can write it like this. So this is now U applied to, and now we have to apply this to a Fock vector. And we simply take the Fock vector where we always take the, and I should also put here holomorphic. So this is U of, then we just take nothing in this zero particle sector. In the one particle sector, we just take what we before called U1, but now the holomorphic part. Maybe let's leave out the one, so without tilde, it's just like a linearized solution. Plus, and then in the two particle, we have to take this plus, and maybe here like with lambda and lambda square lambda plus lambda square U holomorphic, like three copies. Plus and so on. This is what we have. And we know that the norms are preserved. So this means that the norm of U tilde, the holomorphic guy, now this rho tilde norm is equal to this, is the same as the norm of the original guy. Okay, so far so good. Now, so we have a mapping now from the Fock space to the one particle space. But we would like to have an operator from the Fock space to the Fock space, of course. And what we do is simply, this is then what we say call UF. So this is defined as U plus U tensor U plus U tensor U tensor U plus and so on. Maybe I should have said here. So on the zero particle sector is just the identity, on the one particle a subspace, it just, you just act by U. It's, I mean, this is just U. And if you go, it should map to this, to the two particle sector, you just take like tensor product of this by itself and so on. So this is now a mapping from basically like the ingoing Fock space to the outgoing Fock space. And since like this property then lifts to the Fock space, it is like an isometry. Well, and this is a little bit tricky because what we can say now is like the UF of, well, first of all, for vectors of this type, so zero plus U hol plus U hol tensor U hol plus and so on, is the same as the norm of the argument here. So this is norm preserving, but only for vectors of this specific form. So where all the arguments are the same, basically, or they are all formed of the same one particle vector U holomorphic. But then it turns out that if you now polarize, and so expand in powers of lambda, of course I forgot here the factor of lambda and lambda square and so on, and expand in powers of lambda, that this really gives that this UF from F to F tilde is really like complex unitary. Well, then we have like a unitary evolution on Fock spaces, and this is just as in quantum field theory. Okay, so this is like kind of how it seems to work. As I said, seems to, because we are just writing this up, and I mean there could always be surprises. And in fact, there are a few remarks I wanted to make, which also explain a little bit like, okay, really what the connection is, what is missing, and so on. Okay, or maybe first of all, are there questions? Yes?
Conservation of the norm of these two Fock spaces has any physical significance?
But this should just be the usual unitarity of the time evolution. This operator you can think of as the S matrix, the usual scattering matrix. So this UF, you can also, I mean, physicists would probably call it S, but S we have used already, is why I didn't want to do it. So this is like really like the scattering operator, which maps like an ingoing Fock state to an outgoing Fock state. And this operator is then unitary, so it preserves the norm, probabilities conserved, and all of that. Okay, maybe just a few remarks, like things which I find maybe good and not so good. I mean, there are still a few drawbacks. I should mention them too, of course. But maybe first of all, what I like about this construction is that this, the complex structure on the bosonic jets. Suppose you take an electromagnetic, like you start from a classical electromagnetic potential on the bosonic potentials. So this builds in the frequency splitting. So usually when you want to like perform the second quantization of the, say, of scalar field. I mean, the electromagnet is even more difficult because of this Gupta-Bleuler and all of that. So just take a scalar field and you want to second quantize that, and this involves like a splitting of the classical solution space into two subspaces. Well, in Minkowski space, you just take the subspace of positive and negative frequency, of course. So this frequency splitting is kind of crucial for the construction. And this has the drawback that once you are in curved space-time, there's no longer a unique way of doing it. And here, the construction does not involve a frequency splitting. But if you then look at the how this symplectic form and so on looks like, then you see that this operator S, which we had, or J similarly, that in Minkowski space, they do involve the frequency splitting. So the frequency splitting in Minkowski space comes out by itself. And the advantage, the potential advantage at least I see, is that this construction now should work similarly also in curved space-time. I mean, we never use specific properties of Minkowski space. And in this case, then the S and J should again involve some kind of canonical frequency splitting. Yeah, and to me, Doug, this is a bit similar to this construction of this fermionic projector state or the fermionic signature operator, which in the fermionic case gives a unique definition or generalization of frequency splitting in the time-dependent situation. But it seems that here this construction gives something similar for bosonic potentials. Although I must admit, I don't really understand in detail how this comes up or how this works in curved space-time. Okay, now let me mention more like the open problem. What about fermionic Fock spaces? Right now, we just have a symmetric Fock space. So we'd say everything is just bosonic. What about the fermions? And one way of understanding this is like that the fermionic jets, they always involve pairs of fermionic wave functions. I mean, I don't know if you remember this formula, so we had like this delta F, which was our jet, say V is delta F. This had then the form minus delta psi, say at the point X, star psi of X minus psi of X star delta psi of X. So this was the structure. And you see there's always a psi and a delta psi, and here too. So therefore, even if you think of the usual way that you if we kind of replace those psis by anti-commuting operators, by fermionic field operators, this combination here would again be bosonic, and therefore it would make sense to work here with a symmetric Fock space. But so the remaining question is like, I mean, now we just only have like these combinations, only these products are now correspond to field operators, but can we also represent the individual factors as operator products? And this is in fact a little bit tricky, and this is then closely related to, or should be closely related to, this mechanism which I showed you yesterday with this fragmentation of the measure. Okay. Let's see, is this all I wanted to say, or was this? Yeah, I think that seems pretty much it. I mean, now we're a bit early, but this gives us a bit more time for discussion in case you have comments on all of this. Okay, fine. So in fact, I was also wondering. I mean, let me just tell you what my conclusion was. So I mean, basically you say, well, if we have the operator J, why not just, well, we just change the notation, we call JI, and that's it. What else is there to do? Okay. This is something one could do. On the other hand, what would be good to have, suppose you have now a jet, that you want to write this in the following form. You want to split this up into a holomorphic and anti-holomorphic part. So like you write this as U holomorphic plus U anti-holomorphic. You want to do it like this, and then I have this formula as 1/2 times 1 minus J minus IJ U plus 1/2 times 1 plus IJ U. If you have a complexification, then these formulas make perfect sense. But now if you say, well, I just define J as being I, then you run into trouble here. Because then if you set J equal to I, then you have like here plus one, like in this, if you now set J equal to I, then what you get here is just 1/2 times 1 plus 1 U plus 1/2 times 1 minus 1 U. In other words, you only have the holomorphic part. There is no anti-holomorphic part anymore. Yes. Okay. So this is just the ordinary sum of these operators. Well, just, I mean, what you, I mean, also what I tried first, I just say, well, let's call JI, and that's then the complex version. But then the drawback is that if you want to decompose a jet into its holomorphic and anti-holomorphic parts, there is only one of them. I mean, there is only this holomorphic guy left, and there is no anti-holomorphic one. And my conclusion was that by complexifying first, you kind of double the dimension. And then there's the holomorphic and the anti-holomorphic are both non-zero. And adding them gives you kind of, this is kind of the real valued guy, if you wish. So you can write something like, you have a real, say, if you say z is equal to x plus iy, I mean, we start from x. Now by complexifying, I add this y artificially to get complex numbers. And this makes it possible to write x as z plus z bar. This is kind of this formula. On the other hand, if you don't have the, if you don't, didn't introduce the y in the first place, then kind of this decomposition here, and of course with the 1/2, becomes kind of trivial, because if there's no y, then z is equal to z bar, and then you don't gain anything here. So this is like my conclusion, but I mean, I was also I'm still not fully happy with this. I mean, well, this is how it seems to work. Also, I asked Nicky Cameron, and he told me, well, this is what people always do when they construct like complex structures, that you first take this complexification, you double the dimension, and then you have this holomorphic and enter-holomorphic subspaces. So this seems to be the kind of standard construction, as far as I understood it. Okay, well then, let's have coffee a bit earlier. So the when should we meet again then?
Coffee breaks in half an hour, should we meet at 35?
Okay, sounds good.